गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी वुड लुक एट द आर्ट ऑफ द मीडियल रिलीज ड्यूरिंग टोटल नी रिप्लेसमेंट। आई एम योर फ्रेंड वैभव। इन टुडेज टॉक वी विल टॉक अबाउट सम सिंपल कंसेप्ट, हाउ टू ऑर्गेनाइज आवर थॉट्स इन टर्म्स ऑफ अ क्लॉक, अ ट्राइंगल एंड लेयर्स। मोर अबाउट इट सब्सिक्वेंटली। वील लुक एट द एनाटमी एंड वील सी हाउ द आर्ट एंड साइंस ऑफ मीडियल रिलीज ड्यूरिंग नी रिप्लेसमेंट combined together to give you optimal result. So when we talk of medial release, I want you to think in three things. One is the clock, which is how we release in an anti-clockwise fashion. And you'll see that if this is the right knee, we start from the 6 o'clock position and go all the way around the knee in this fashion here so as to get our optimal release. Similarly, we do a top to down release, meaning that the top layer here and then go down towards the foot end of the patient. And finally, we go from inside to the outside of the knee to achieve a perfect medial release. I mean, these may sound a bit unconventional and difficult to digest, but you will see that once you have mastered this concept of the clock, the levels and the layers, you would never feel any difficulty in balancing the most difficult knees. Now let's look at what the knee looks from the top. So this is how our knee looks from the top, and you'll see that there are different soft tissue structure all around. This is the kneecap or the patella here. These are the medial meniscus, this is the lateral meniscus, this is the capsule, and all these structures are here in this fashion. So if you see Our release is from this direction, and in a clockwise fashion, in an anti-clockwise fashion rather, we start our release somewhere from here and we go all the way up to 11 o'clock if need be. Not all cases would require this extensive release, and in most cases your release will stop up to this 3 o'clock. When you have got a difficult knee, you might need to start or progress your release in this direction, reach up to here, which is the PCL, and may even go up to the popliteus. So this is a very simplified concept to understand the medial release during a knee replacement. Similarly, as I said, if you look on the medial aspect of the knee joint, you'll see that the release starts from the top and it goes all the way down. And if you look at the structure, it more or less resembles an inverted pyramid. And that's the way our releases should be. Your maximum release will have to happen in the level 1, which is the topmost layer here. Then, if you need to balance, you may touch the structures here. And rarely do you need to go to the level 3. And we'll see what structures constitute 1, 2, and 3 in this talk. As I said, it is top to bottom approach. So you go from the knee to the foot end. And finally, you see, this is the structure. If I remove the bones, this is how the knee looks in the axial section. And you will see that right from the meniscus all the way, you'll see the structures have different layers. And it is from inside to outside that we release. So the structure closes to the bone, gets released first, and then you go in the outward direction. So in effect, whatever I have told you means that you have to envision the knee in a three-dimensional concept. From top, you look at it in an axial plane, then you look at it in sagittal plane, and then you look at it in the coronal plane. So releasing medial, although it's the deformity would appear, or for our own simplification, we have classified varus as a uniplanar deformity. It is actually a triplanar deformity, or it has component from the structures present in all the three planes. And to get to the balancing or the fine balance is when you can understand and release the structure in this three-dimensional arena. So this is how the knee looks. This is the bony anatomy, and you'll see that's the region where your semimembranous is attached. This is the attachment of the superficial medial ligament. On the posterior aspect, you'll see that this is where the PCL attaches. That's the origin of the popliteus, and somewhere here is the posterior oblique ligament. Now, Netters described this layers in great detail. So the first layer, as I said, we release from inside to outside, but this is from the outside to inside. So beneath the skin is the first layer, which is the superficial layer, which is constituted by the sartorius and the fascia. The second layer, which is the middle layer, comprises of superficial medial collateral ligament, posterior oblique ligament, the MPFL, the medial patellar retinaculum, and semimembranosus. Deeper to this are the deep medial collateral ligament in the capsule, and of course inside the knee are the meniscus, and also noteworthy is the medial head of gastrocnemius, which is in the knee. So when we release, it is from the deep layer to the superficial layer, and when we describe, it is from the first to the third layer. Once again, a bit of osteology, and you will see that the MPFL, this is the vastus medialis obliquus, that is the posterior oblique ligament, the SMCL, the patellar tendon, and this is where all this attaches. So if you look, this is the knee capsule here, this is the innermost layer, then you will see that there is some medial retinaculum, which we need to know, that is the MPFL, and on this side is the superficial MCL. So all of these are the important structure on the medial side. And before I proceed, some more detail about the medial collateral ligament, because that's the most important structure that we need to understand. And you'll see that this is the joint line. Now the collateral ligament has two components, the deep and the superficial. Deep is the short one here. It starts here where the DMCL written and inserts just below the joint line. It's a short ligament. Whereas the SMCL is the long ligament, and that's how it looks like. So if you look, that's a pretty long ligament. It is approximately 3 centimeters above the joint line on the femoral side and around 6.2 plus minus 6.6. So that means that in any case, it is less than 7 centimeters away from the joint line. It's very important to understand the two components of the medial collateral ligament. In most cases, you will restrict your release only to your DMCL and rarely touch the SMCL. Now let's go and see what we release. So the moment we take this in skin incision, that's where we are. The main structure that needs to be preserved is the infrapatellar branch of the saphenous nerve, and you will see the fascia after cutting the skin, followed by the medial retinaculum and the MPFL. Once you incise that, you will reach the capsule and you will see the component of the deep medial collateral ligament. That's how you will reach here. That's your SMCL. This is your the meniscus, the capsule, and the attachment of deep medial collateral ligament. And in the next image, you will see how I am releasing the deep medial collateral ligament. You can use a cautery or a bowie, or you can use a small 15 number or 23 number knife. As I said, I believe in the clock concept of the release, and you will see all the structure where they're lying. So the first structure that you release is the capsule here. It starts and it's completely encompassing the knee joint. Then you release the DMCL. If you need be, you release the semimembranosus and posterior oblique ligament. Rarely you have to release the PCL and popliteus. If you still are not balanced, you may think in terms of the SMCL and rarely in terms of the PES. This is one of the hand-drawn diagram that I have. So in this hand-made diagram, you can see that I've started from roughly 6 o'clock. So if this is a right knee and I'm standing in front of the knee, you'll see that the capsule starts, I'm releasing the capsule all the way around from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock. Around between 4 and 3 is the DMCL. Between 2 and 1 are the semimembranosus and the posterior oblique ligament. Around 12 o'clock position is the PCL, and then around 10 and 11 o'clock is the popliteus. So in most cases, your release would be confined between 6 and 3. If you're doing a unicompartmental knee replacement, definitely between 6 and 4, you should stop, avoiding to release the DMCL. If you need to release more, you can do a bit of semimembranosus and posterior oblique ligament, and finally PCL. So that's the area that you have reached. As I said, you start from here, go all the way here, and you see here at around 2 o'clock, you can release the semimembranosus and then further a posterior oblique ligament. I've completed a release all the way around from the 6 o'clock here, and I've gone all the way nearly to 2 o'clock or 1 o'clock here. After you release, this is how the orientation of posterior oblique ligament is here, and you can see that I have released the posterior oblique ligament. Once you have crossed that, it is, and if you are still unbalanced, as I said, you can also release the PCL, and that's the reason why I think that this whole debate of whether you should be a CR or a PS surgeon is futile, because in some cases in which the PCL is acting as a central tether, you must release it to balance your knees. Otherwise, you would end up cutting more tibia, which is not a good idea. So while for 70 to 80% of knees in which you don't reach up to the PCL, whether you do a CR or PS, both have equally good results. But there are a tiny proportion of varus knees in which PCL acts as a center tether and contributes to varus. And these are the knees in which, in my personal opinion, PS implant is better suited. Coming to the zone concept, as I said, once you have understood the concept of the axial or the clock, you should also think about the zones. So the topmost zone is the zone 1, where the capsule and some element of DMCL is attached. Zone 2 is the zone in which the maximum number of contributing structures are there, which is the DMCL, the semimembranosus and posterior oblique ligament. And finally, the zone 3 is where your SMCL, gracilis and semi-T is here. So as I said, this is 1, 2 and 3. Top layer is capsule and osteophyte, DMCL, and then the semimembranosus, PES and SMCL. If you have released everything and you have to come to grade 3 or stage or level 3 of the release. So as I said, level 1 is the capsule and DMCL, you have done with it. Level 2 is the semimembranosus, POL, you're done with it. And you're still unbalanced and you feel that you need to release more, you can turn your attention towards the PES and the SMCL. So there are two ways of dealing with the residual deformity. One is that you use a periosteum to sharply dissect out the PES and the SMCL, which is described here. As I said, this is the 6 cm margin that you should use, and you can externally rotate the leg to kind of give you the space. Alternatively, you can do what is called as a pie crusting, in which you selectively elongate the superficial medial collateral ligament. So that's the way it is done. 5 needle pricks at one time and then assess. 5 pricks and assess. Remember AF and PE, which is a small mnemonic for atrial fibrillation pulmonary embolism. That means the anterior fiber contributes to tightness in flexion, AF, and the posterior fiber contribute to the tightness in extension, that is PE. So it is helpful to do that. So once you have reached a level where you want a level 3 release, you can think either in terms of a subperiosteal release of the PES and the SMCL, or you can think about doing an SMCL. Coming to another trick of balancing the knee with a release, this is actually strictly not release, but this is in reduction osteotomy, in which you can mark out an area and do a bumpectomy. Again, the whole idea is that it increases the medial space. Now people ask me what structures are tight in this. This is a rough table to suggest what structure contribute to the extension and the flexion gap. And as I said, the superficial MCL has got 2 components which contribute selectively to the extension and the flexion gap. Deep MCL contributes to both, whereas all other structure contributes mainly to the extension gap. This is a very interesting study published in the Journal of Arthroplasty, and which shows that all the structures, right from the ACL, PCL, deep MCL, semimembranosus, reduction osteotomy and PES, and the superficial MCL contribute to the tightness medially and can be improved with the release. So before I end, I would like to tell you that it is easy to release or balance a knee, especially medial release for a varus knee, provided you understand the concept of tightness in 3 planes: in axial plane, in coronal plane, and also in sagittal plane. So think in terms of clock. So you start from 6 o'clock, go all the way up to 12 and perhaps sometimes even to 2 o'clock. Think in terms of level, 1, 2, 3, top level is towards the knee, the level 3 is towards the foot, and finally think from inside to outside. So the deeper structure release needs to be released first, and to the outermost structure you reach at the very end. So try to conserve bone and try to preserve bone. Try to create a rectangular gap by getting your soft tissue in place. Remember our old words, knee replacement is primarily a soft tissue surgery, and it still holds true. I thank you for your attention.